just picture that, Target Field, that is sleep time. And that's only crime reported to the CDC, the Center on Disease Control. So that's pretty shocking, right? Yep. I do this work because every time I walk to my car, I have my keys in my hand with the keys pointed out. And I think I've done this since I started driving, but my husband recently noticed it. He said, "Why are you putting the keys?" And I said, "Oh, I always do this." And he said, "Why?" And I said, "Because it helps me feel safe." And I think that he was really shocked, and I think also saddened to think that I think every day about how to keep myself safe. And that is a reality for many women in our state and across the country. We have to realize that there's a continuum of harassment and violence that many women face every day. And I think it's important to note that when we first started talking about our work to end child sex trafficking, Minnesota Girls Are Not For Sale. How many of you have heard of Minnesota Girls Are Not For Sale? If you haven't, it's okay. Great. A lot of you have. So that's awesome. Well, when we started that work, it took a while for Minnesotans to believe and understand that girls in our state were being sold for sex. I mean, it was shocking, and I was on the board of the foundation at the time, and the board, I think it took a little while for us to actually believe that it happened here. But people believed it, and we started working together, and 7 years later, we've passed policy, we've increased investments, and we're working to end demand to ensure that Minnesota is safe for all girls and all boys. That's awesome, right?
Circle the wagon. because the university is, are you ready? Both races, state of Texas, in one breath. Whoa, man, on the totem pole. Now, normally you could expect me to raise my hand and maybe a small objection, but it occurred to me she spent a lot more time constructing that sentence than I had to deconstruct the sentence. So I simply folded out my books and papers and walked out of the room. Following me quickly was my friend Bill. He said, Eric, did you hear what she said? I said, yes, Bill, I did. Well, Eric, wasn't that racist? I said, yes, Bill, it was. Well, Eric, why did you say something? Because I'm tired, Bill. Why didn't you? If it's a value that you hide behind and hold up as a member of this community, why do you think it's the job of a person who's been injured to stand up for your values? Isn't it you? I think we all have that moment where we realize it's us. We have to stand up for the values and the things we believe in to build the community we want. We have to have that realization that today, I'm going to speak for what I believe in and not expect someone else to lead for me. We're here today with the incredible leadership of the Minnesota Women's Foundation because they're asking us to use our voice and join them to not only be behind them, but once in a while, be in front. Thank you for being here.
Together in the next 7 years. That's why I'm thrilled to welcome Ted Bunch this
here in Minnesota is really unprecedented. And I really want to acknowledge that, Lee. Please. When we started the work, founded the organization with my friend and still business partner, Tony Porter. I'm out of New York, he's out of Charlotte. When we started this 15 years ago, there was a lot of concern about men getting involved with the space around working and violence against women for lots of reasons. You know, the women were the leading, they were the leaders in this, and we're concerned that men would do what men do, which is take over, right? That they built this all this way, this women's movement, and violence against women movement, built it all this way, and, you know, so there was some, you know, kind of a little bit of mistrust in what is this really going to be. And we were able to establish ourselves as really allies and standing in solidarity with women, and because of that, if we are the leaders that you say we are, which I think we are, it's only because of women like you, women's organizations. We're really a reflection of you, we really are, because we could not have done it unless we had that type of endorsement. So I really appreciate that, really. So, good to see you, man. I'm from New York, I came from LA, but I was in Memphis, and I was at the airport Sunday night on my way to Memphis. I'm watching the game, and it was a great game, but there was about a minute left, and Drew Brees had the ball one more time, and you could see it on the sideline. He was like, okay, let's go. He wasn't worried. Did you see the confidence? I was like, oh, geez, I got to go to Minnesota. I hope they win, like, the boy, it's going to be bad if they don't win. It's going to be a rough morning. So I'm rooting for the Vikings, right? I'm rooting for the Vikings. And you pulled it out, and it was amazing. So congratulations. I'm really excited for your city, about the Super Bowl being here, and the possibility of the Vikings being here. And go Lynx as well. All right. So we have a lot to cover and a little bit of time. I appreciate you all being here. So let me see where I can start. As we look at the issue of violence against women, domestic violence, sexual assault, sexual harassment, right now the way that we deal with things has been through intervention, right? Something has to happen, and then we respond to it. That's intervention, whether it's sexual harassment in the workplace, whether it's domestic violence or sexual assault, someone has to be the perpetrator of it, someone has to be a victim, someone has to go to HR, someone has to go to the hospital, someone has to get arrested. That's intervention. We want to go upstream to prevention where it never happens in the first place. That makes sense, right? And that bridge from intervention to prevention is men. It's us. It's how we are as men, but also how we raise our boys. Right? Because we keep passing down these generational messages to our children. The socialization of men. And I want to talk about that, the collective socialization of men. And as Lee said, this is not an indictment on men, but it's actually just an invitation to men. We've all done things that, as part of our collective socialization, we would not do today. Even in the recent news around sexual harassment, I think that every man has had to look back in his past and say, what have I done? Myself included. I don't think there's a man who hasn't either done something that has crossed the line or has witnessed another man doing something that crossed the line and didn't say anything about it. I don't think he exists, myself included. So this is not an indictment. It's really about times are changing, and they need to change. They need to change, and here we are. So we're going to go into this conversation open, not feeling indicted, hopefully, right? But I'm going to challenge some things about how we are as men, including my own development as a man in doing these things. So why is it important that we are part of the solution? When we look at violence against women in the United States, domestic violence, sexual assault, if I look at all of the men in Minnesota or in the United States, the statistics are the same. About what percentage of men do you think actually perpetrate the violence that we're talking about, domestic violence, sexual assault? Any idea of the percentage? It's a little bit more, it's probably around 12-15%. So let's say it's 15%. 85% of us are doing the right thing. 85% of us, right? So the overwhelming majority of violence against women is men's violence, but the overwhelming majority of men are not violent, but we're silent about the violence other men perpetrate, and that silence is as much the problem as the violence is. So, and we know that men know stop swinging when the cops come. And that's something. But we've always had the latitude as men to get away with violence in the home, because that domestic violence was seen as a private issue or a public issue historically. Private, does that serve men or women? Serve men, right? So it's been a private issue serving men, right? And we've been taught to be silent. If I see a man hitting his wife or girlfriend in Minneapolis or anywhere else in the state or outside of Minnesota, and I see him hitting his wife or girlfriend, I walk over to him today and say, knock it off. What does he tell me?
Mind your own business.
Thank you. Mind your own business, exactly. He says, mind your own business, right? So, now we've never had this conversation, but we know the answer to that, don't we? Because we've been socialized, we've been taught that this is the message that we're supposed to give to men. You mind your business, and I'm going to mind mine as it relates to the woman in your life, right? So, we have to change that. So why is it important? This is why it's important. Does anyone have children here? Oh, wow, great. Anyone have daughters? Wonderful. How old is your daughter, sir?
She's
16. 16. Who has a daughter under about 10 years old? Anybody? How old is your daughter?
Three.
What is her name?
Fern.
Fern? Nice. All right. Okay, parents. So, I have a daughter also. So this is why it's important for us, right? So, my daughter is 27. Her name is Maya. Maya went to, she graduated UVA about 4 years ago. She went to University of Virginia. And Maya, in her last year at UVA, wanted to live off campus, right? She was just tired of the dorm life, wanted to live with two other young women who were also seniors at UVA. Now, I'm about a six-hour drive from Maya. I live on Long Island. About 6 hours to get there. And God forbid, Maya needed me. I'm not going to JFK and getting a flight. I'm getting in the car, and I'm going. If Fern needed you and you're 6 hours away, would that be a long 6 hours for you? Yeah. Just gotta go, right? I mean, I don't even like presenting it hypothetically to you. It gets me a little upset. It really does. I don't like it. So 6 hours away. So God forbid she needed me for something. It's gonna take me 6 hours to get there. She's not home with me anymore. I can't protect my daughter. She's 6 hours away. And I can't protect my daughter. 6 hours away. So Maya wanted to live off campus. I gotta shake that off. Maya wanted to live off campus, so her mom and I drive down, we look at the apartment. And we find a place, and you know, she liked it, the other girls liked it too. And young women, I should say, liked it also. And so I drive back home, and Maya calls me and says, Dad, when you bring my things down, will you bring me a pair of your old shoes or boots? Why would she want a pair of my old shoes or boots?
Make it look like a man.
Make it look like a man lives there. Great. Why does she need to make it look like a man lives there? So that other men are deterred to give the impression that a man is there, right? Why does she need to give the impression that a man is there?
Makes her look less vulnerable.
Right, so she feels safer, protected, less at risk. Now, does she, well, first of all, you think I got us some boots or shoes? Wait a minute. Man, listen, I wear size 11. I want to get rid of 16, dip them in mud, put some blood stains on the toe. They can't be big enough. They cannot be big enough. Come on, somebody. They can't be big enough. Yes, I got them for it, yeah. So, now, do you think Maya put them outside the door 15% of the time? 100% of the time, because she doesn't know who is going to harm her and who is not going to harm her, right? Same thing with the keys Sonny was talking about, Wolverine. She doesn't know. So wouldn't it be great that when Fern grows up and goes away, she doesn't put shoes outside of the door? That's what this conversation is about. That's what we want to get to. How do we get there? We have to get there by having conversations. Because we are, not you, but men, are most of the problem, and we're going to be most of the solution. It's really up to us. So we have to stop being silent, and we have to raise our voice differently. Right? We have to raise our voice differently. So, thank you. So we're going to show this quick little video that just talks about the issue. It's about 2 minutes long, if you don't mind. Thank you.
Thank you.
unwritten rules and agreements, unnegotiated deals and codes of silence that other men come to expect from us. This collectively defines many aspects of our manhood. I remember asking a 12-year-old boy, a football player, so how would you feel if your coach told you in front of all the other players that you're playing like a girl? I thought he would say, I'd be mad, I'd be angry, I'd be sad. But no, the boy told me it would destroy me. I said, wow. If it would destroy him being told that he's playing like a girl, what are we as men teaching him about girls? If we continue to treat women and girls as if they are of less value, the property of men and sexual objects, we continue to maintain a culture that reinforces discrimination and abuse towards them.
It is important to rethink and reshape how we as men have been taught to act and behave. We need to hold on to the many wonderful aspects of manhood and remove those things that hold us back.
We need to stop laughing and begin challenging inappropriate comments made about women and girls. We need to educate ourselves, our sons, and other young men and boys. Let's be the solution.
Our liberation as men is directly tied to the liberation of women. The cause of men works with men and women to create a world where all men and all boys are loving and respectful, and all women and girls are valued and safe.
Help us create a new world by being part of the next generation of man.
Better, and anyone else on the gender spectrum, actually those lives become better. LGBTQ I, two-spirited, everyone's life becomes better. So, our work has been in the military, colleges, universities, all over the country, all professional sports, do a lot of work with men, business leaders such as yourself, coaches, been in lots of high schools, colleges, businesses, professional athletes over the years, probably in front of about, I think the number is about, well, this is our social media campaign also. We always have a lot of things going on social media, presenting the information. I just want to give you a snapshot of this before I get to the meat of the presentation. Now, in front of about a million people over the last 15 years, literally in front of that many people. We also have a TED Talk that you might want to check out by the co-founder, other co-founder, Tony Porter. That's on TED, and there's a couple other TED Talks. Justin Baldoni, anyone know Justin Baldoni from, he's an actor, from Jane the Virgin, he just did one also. We helped him to create that, so that's another really good one. So I wanted to also highlight our Live Respect curriculum. It's a high school curriculum that we wrote with Scholastic, and I want to bring it up because it is free online through our website. Just got to put your email in, you can download it. But I wanted to bring it up because it addresses the issue of dating violence prevention, what a healthy, respectful relationship can look like and should look like. We address homophobia in school and in sports, bullying, right? All of those things. Because all the bullying we look at, when we look at it, it's gender-based, right? It's not the captain of a football team that gets bullied, right? It's really gender-based. And I also wanted to just bring up this statistic. What was interesting, we surveyed 300 high school boys from all different socioeconomic backgrounds, from all different ethnicities. So these were from affluent private schools to underserved schools in some of the inner city communities that we work in. And 81% of our high school boys do not know what consent is. 81%. Well, that explains a lot. It explains sexual assault in the military. It explains sexual assault on college campuses. It explains why girls between the ages of 16 and 24 are most at risk at the highest rate. 75% of sexual assault happened between that age range because our boys think no means try harder. And these are good boys. They're our boys. But we don't take the time as men, as fathers, to have the conversations with our boys that we do with our daughters.